actually running at the Roundup South Key, at the Royal Belgian Institute for Space Learning, where I'm working. I consider this talk as a success if I can convince at least some of you to help us to improve this radio meter zoom in the future. So first, I'm going to introduce you to radio meter research. Then I will talk about what the radio meter zoom is doing in this story. And finally, the biggest part of my presentation will be about improvements we are planning to do on the radio meter zoom. So first of all, I think everybody has already seen a meteor. So if you're standing outside during nighttime, especially during meteor shower, you see sign from time to time flash of light, and this is called a meteor. So meteors are emitting light, but they are not, or they are barely emitting radio waves themselves. But what they do is that they create an ionized trail in the atmosphere, and radio waves reflect on this ionized trail. So that's the principle on which we are working. We have put somewhere a transmitter, a radio beacon, and the radio waves from this beacon are bouncing off the meteoroid or the trail left behind the meteoroid after it went through the atmosphere, and can be received somewhere else. Like this, we have built a whole network in Belgium. Belgium is a small country west of Germany, and so we have one radio beacon in the south of Belgium, and we have 25 stations all over the country. Each station generates a so-called spectrogram, which is shown here. And on the horizontal axis is the time, the vertical axis is the frequency, so the time here is 5 minutes, which means that each station generates 288 images per day, and if, since we have 25 stations, it means about 8,000 images for the whole network. Asking a student to process all these images, or a collaborator to process all these images, seems to be against the Geneva Convention. So we are not going to do that. So we try to develop automatic detection algorithms. And what you see in this image is horizontal line. Does anyone has an idea what this could be? It's at a fixed frequency. This is the direct signal from our radio beacon. Then we have these short vertical lines here, all with this rectangle around it. These are the meters, these are the objects we are interested in. And then you have also these slanted lines. These are in fact airplanes, because the radio waves also bounce off the hull of an airplane. So in fact, we have built a much better airplane detector than a meter detector, unfortunately. So here it works very well for an automatic detection algorithm, because the reflections are vertical lines, which are easy to detect. But sometimes it also fails completely, because especially during meteor showers, and these are the moments we are most interested in, bigger particles enter the Earth's atmosphere, and these cause more complex reflections, like you can see here. And for a computer, it's very difficult to detect these, and also to find out which parts belong together in these reflections. But for the human eye, it's not so difficult. So this is the second part of my talk. So this is why we have set up the radio meteor zoo. This is a science project, because we ask people to use their eyes to identify the meteors. And this is what the radio meteor zoo project is about. This project is hosted on the Zooniverse platform, that is best known for project called Galaxy Zoo, which was their first one. So now, since 2 years, we are also running on this, the Radio Meteor Zoo. I hope I'm able to start this video. So this shows what we ask the volunteers to do. So you go to a website called radiomediazoo.eu, and then you click on the classify button, and there you get this spectrogram, these images, and you draw a rectangle around everything you consider to be a meteor. And we also tell people that they don't have to be afraid to make mistakes because actually each image is shown to 10 different volunteers. And what we do, we make aggregated result out of them. We look at regions that are identified by at least half of the people and consider these regions to be real meteors. Like this, we were able to attract almost 7,000 volunteers in 2 years, and those volunteers processed or identified almost half a million or more than half a million radio meteors in our data. But we also see that people lose quite quickly their interest in the project, and so we need to innovate all the time to keep their to keep them engaged into this project. That's the last part of my talk, is about our future plans to improve the Radio Meteor Zoo. One of the ideas is to bring meteors to the classroom. Meteor research is a very good example of interdisciplinary science for primary schools and high schools. So we would like to develop educational material. We also would like to create inspiring or motivating videos. Like to go from time to time to schools to talk about meteors myself, but I see it more effective if we could train the teachers and then they bring it to their classroom. And finally, what is also very important is we as a scientific community, we are used to speaking English, but for general public it's not that evident. So we have also to translate the content to their own language. For this last point, I can do it, for example, for Dutch. That's my mother tongue. I also speak a bit of French, so I can also help on that. But other languages, it's not doable for me. Also, for these first 3 points, I think there we need people who are really used to work together with teachers to help us to develop these educational materials for us. Second thing we would like to do is to introduce a skill factor, which is an indication how good the volunteer is. The red rectangles are the result from the aggregation algorithm, so this is the average meters as identified, and the purple, especially this big rectangle here, is what one of the volunteers has done. So apparently this person has done a bad job, but I have also opposite examples where people are doing a very good job. So we could assign a weight or a skill factor to a person. And it could, for example, say that we give more complicated images to more skilled volunteers, or that we give them a higher skill factor such that we need less people to process a particular image. Very closely related to that is to provide automatic feedback to people. I believe that nobody is really trying to sabotage our project, but sometimes we see results like this, and these are definitely people that didn't understand what they were supposed to do. I detect it now like a month after, and I send those people a small message explaining them, okay, you're supposed to do that, that, and that. Look on that page for some examples. And they are very, they appreciate that a lot that I do that. Much better would be if this could be done automatically and immediately after they have submitted their classification, such that they do a better job in the future. And the last thing is that we would like to apply machine learning algorithms to this classification. So we have a database of more than 500,000 classified meters, and I'm convinced that it should be able, or a computer program should be able to learn how this how a meter looks like and should be able to put rectangles themselves. This is also a feedback that we get from a lot of volunteers that the task gets a bit boring after a while to draw out all these rectangles. Imagine that we could show an image with the rectangles already put on it and ask the people if the rectangles are put correctly or not. This would be much more interesting for the volunteers and also will improve the speed of the classification a lot. But also for this, we need some help, some support from people specialized in image recognition and in machine learning algorithms. So this is my last slide, the conclusion. The BRANS project, the radio meteor project that we are running, detects radio meteors using a network of 25 receivers all over Belgium. They generate 8,000 spectrograms per day, which is too much to process manually. Thanks to the radio meteor zoom, we were able to study 10 meteor showers in the last 2 years. And last but not least, we have plans to extend this radio meteor zoom, but we are currently looking for some partners to help us with that, who are specialized in either public outreach or in machine learning algorithms, and also for funding to set up this collaboration. Thank you very much. Questions?
Questions?
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.